back with Grant's pickup truck. We drove out to Dansville, Pennsylvania, the home of the QWERTY, the typewriter, keyboard, and QWERTY, that's the kind of fame. But we gave them a couple $100, bought them pizza, and we said, we use your canning line. And we literally had, like, hockey helmets on because it was exploding a lot. We used an ice cream scooper. We had a big liquid nitrogen drum. You can't close those things. So for 4 hours, 5 hours, it was spilling out the back of the pickup truck. Looked like we were transporting, like, an atom bomb. And got in there, dropped it in the brewery, and then we would just take a little scoop of ice cream, put it in the cap, and, you know, try and close it. And then when we cap it, most would explode, but we got to, you know, about four or five. Maybe we got about 20 by the end of the 2 hours. And then when we expanded to our brewery, we were getting up to about like 800 to 1,000 a day. We used to put stickers on the wall and say, like, okay, this is the best thing we have. And then now let's reach for the next goal, 1,200, 1,400. Eventually, we started doing double shifts, and we used a mobile canner. And the mobile canner never worked with nitrogen before and didn't want to do it. And they didn't want to work with our can size. The widget cans were slightly taller, and they didn't want to have to reconfigure their stuff. So we kind of taught that mobile canner how to do it, and now they do it all over the East Coast. But we ended up getting up to like 20,000. We wouldn't be able to expand with that. So then we found a co-packer, and now we can do about 400,000 cans a day. Hopefully we'll need to do that one day. We don't need to do that every day. But it's a very big difference. Like, one of our first advisors was a guy named Tom Long, who's an investor. He was the former CEO of Coors. And we used to have, like, Thursday morning conversations with him and Grant. And I remember him going, all right, boys, like, he's still there. All right, boys, yeah, how many cans you guys up to right now? And we were literally using the Dixie Seamer at that point. It was before we found the mobile canner. And we're like, we're doing about, like, you know, four an hour. He's like, what, 4,000? We're like, yeah, I don't have four. We're doing about four an hour. He's like, okay. He's like, I'm not used to that. He's like, basically, let's wait a year or two, and then let's have these conversations again. But, yeah, I mean, you have to find co-packers, and they have to believe in you, because all the co-packers have, you know, very limited amount of line time. So they only work, there's only 24 hours in a day. And so they don't accept all the brands. And then the big thing is, once you get that co-packer, you actually really want to sell your product even more, because you don't want, after you're teaching them how to sell coffee in a 7-ounce can, we don't want a competitor to come in. And they want to make sure, you have to sell them to the dream, because they have to believe that they're not going to just make one and then be done, that you're going to be a consistent growth you know, source for them.
So getting the product on the shelf, into the restaurant, into the office, talk to us about what you've learned about some of that. Managing a big logistics operation?
I think, you know, one of the big things we learned is you need good partners, and you need people who are passionate about it. They need to handle it well, you know, from the way that we handle our setup in the back, to the way that we brew, to the way our co-packers brew, to the way it's on the truck. Being shelf stable for us was very important, because you have to expect the unexpected. So you have to expect that a distributor is going to get it, and it might fall on the ground. You have to expect that a distributor might be driving through the country, and it might be snowing, and the truck's going to pull over. It might be a desert temperature. It might be too hot. The tire might blow out. All these kind of things. So by expecting the unexpected, you figure out, okay, well, we have to be shelf stable, and we have to have as long of a life as possible, because then when a distributor finally gets it to where they're selling it, it might have been 2 months, 3 months, and then they want something. So expect the unexpected. And then how you're actually packaging everything to not just get to the grocery store and make sure it gets there safely, which is important, like what kind of equipment you're using, but then also make sure that it's, you know, a good size for once it's on the shelf. And then the grocery store can then say, oh, I can stack four of these, and this will all look good in color. But, yeah, I'd say expect the unexpected and try and make it as durable as possible. And as consistent as possible.
Last area. So you do all this off of cash flow, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's really easy.
Yes.
No financing needed, no assets, no nothing, right?
No.
Talk to us a little bit about how you've gone about fundraising, how many rounds, the types of investors you've been able to bring in. How did you get that initial first wave of investment?
I think that was getting back into the story of don't put up any roadblocks in front of you. There's going to be plenty of roadblocks along the way. So we said, let's just, what do we need to get going to see if we can all quit our jobs here, and let's just go. And so we made it really easy, $1 million for the first round, and tried to get friends and family. We closed it pretty quickly because we had a good tasting product, and it was easy. You know, it wasn't based off of anything but speculation and trust in the people behind it. So that was a relatively easy one. And I've seen a lot of companies try too much at the beginning, and it's great because you have more equity, but it never got off the ground. So we made it really easy at first, and then you know, we've kind of looked at on the next Series A, and what we're doing now, we're in the middle of we're closing our biggest round to date, pretty close to it, and we try and look at who are actual
between that million and now, two other rounds.
Yeah. This one's a pretty significant size one, you know, just being across the country, we're building our team, you know, it's about 50 people now, and maybe more, depending on who we consider all people team members, right, like brand ambassadors that might work one day a week in Texas are still team members to us, you know, so 50 plus people, but I think this one is now, gets back into your question before of like how is it as we're growing. Now we're really basing it on numbers as best as possible. We're looking at comparative companies, bless you, what their exits were, where they were in this stage, where we are compared to other big companies, and kind of going more data driven on this one. But the biggest thing for us has always been an investor who's either purely a money play or is actually going to put feet on the street. You know, our investor on the Pacific Northwest connected us with the biggest distributor in the Pacific Northwest, and that was huge for us. So I think there's a lot of investors that have a lot of great connections, and sometimes that works out, but to actually have someone who's going to roll up your sleeves and put feet on the street is really huge for us.
Cool. Questions? A few topics to go into. Ian?
First of all, your passion shines. I mean, what you're doing is just awesome. When you came up with your different recipes and the cans and the roar and the fact that you made it shelf stable, did you guys just figure that out yourself, or did you use like food scientists? How'd you do it?
Good question. So we started that route. I went to Cornell, and we went up to the Cornell Food Science Program, and we asked them a bunch of questions, and they said it up front. They said, well, we're a university, and we move slow. We move like a university. And we were like, okay, well, we're a business, and we're trying to move pretty fast here.
We don't know anything about
it. But we don't know how to do it. But, you know, we're willing and able to learn. And so we learned little things here and there. And I remember at the Cornell meeting, they said shelf stability, think of it as like two things going at each other. And you have to limit the amount of bad that comes in to your product, and you have to try and elevate as much good as possible. So basically, you're trying to create Guinness in a keg versus the shelf-stable side. So we started thinking, okay, well, how can we manipulate that at home to get close? Okay, so if we're going to try retorting machines, you can buy those online, you know, the big pots, whatever. And so we got a retorting machine, and we started figuring out what levers do we have control over. So whatever businesses have, what control factors do you have? So this coffee is the same exact coffee beans we have. Keg, but it's a slightly different amount of beans that we have in the keg. Maybe it's more, maybe it's less. It's slightly different. It might be a slightly different roast, too, in a slightly, slightly different way. And I don't want to get too into the specifics, but when we first started buying coffee beans, we were actually in between two flavors. And it's like, you know, sometimes if you're just at home, you're like, oh, what tastes better, this or this? Oh, if we mix them together, that's my favorite one. That's what we did. We were in between two different roasts of a Peruvian bean. Darkish roast and a lightish roast. Both were kind of dark medium, light medium. So to this day, we actually use a blend of that. So we had that as a lever. We had two sources of levering that could we increase a little bit more of the dark roast and decrease a little more of the light, or vice versa. So we said, what are our levers? We got to a point where at home, you know, we could get as close to what we thought was tasted like the keg as possible with our retorting machines. And then after that, you've got to find good partners that will, you know, let you, and this is like the thing with co-packing too, and we go there, and we're in the facility, and they don't want you there. And you are not allowed to take pictures, and you are not allowed to look at the equipment, But, you know, with a smile and some free coffee and, you know, like, and some passion, the less you get as far as you can. And so we start figuring out how can we change those levers with these multiple $1 million, you know, equipment that we can't afford, and how can we give them as much knowledge as possible so they respect us, and we're not just trying to say, we want it to taste better. You know, as we said,
and
taste
big.
Is different.
That's,
you know, big. We want it to be a little bit darker in the roast. We want a little more water, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we try to do as much work as possible, figure out what levers we can control, and then how we can actually have bigger players do it.
Thank you.
And these guys, I just go back to when you were first doing the cans, and you went and you locked up some can supply. The same approach, though. It was a partnership approach.
Yeah.
When you went to the source over in Europe, right?
I mean, take it back in the beginning days,
yeah.
Like before we even got into can, I remember we called up Ball at that time before the Argon connection happened, and Monopoly was considered a Monopoly, but we called up Ball and we're like, hey, we want to buy some cans. They're like, oh, perfect, okay, cool. We usually, the minimum is $500,000. We're like, okay, yeah, maybe, but we'll give it to you guys for $250,000. We're like, okay, like, even if we could raise money to afford that, we wouldn't even know where to put those cans. The good news is we got them down to believing in our story to $100,000. We still didn't know where to put those cans. But the really good news was, is Grant's parents were selling their house. So when we do have canning days, I was living in the city, I'd drive at like 4 or 5 a.m., pick up a bunch of people in the city from wherever, all points, from literally down to like East Village, West Village, Financial District, to Upper West Side, Upper East Side, get a whole caravan together, drive out to the brewery. Grant would go to his parents' house, put pallets of cans in the back of his pickup truck, we'd all meet at the brewery, and then start canning. But yeah, we talked that relationship down, and that was a lot of fun.
So your channel strategy has probably changed. Why did you change? What happened to make you change your strategy? And what do you see happening now,
yep,
and in the future that's going to make you change?
Great question. It's always changing. We're always adapting with it. You know, the evolution is that creature that adapts the best, right? It's not the strongest or the fastest, it's the one most willing to adapt. So we're adapting, and we're always testing things, we're trying to stay fresh. But to get down to it, when we first launched kegs, you know, Grant was brewing it in the garage, me and Justin were picking up kegs from the garage, double parking in New York City, getting tickets anyway, because they give you a ticket to make a commercial zone, they don't care that you're in the car, and that was tough. We got to 200 or so accounts, and that was impossible. We had to start, literally building a team of our own drivers with our own cars and parents' cars. So we said, okay, well, what's the future? What channel can we actually make the most revenue on? And it was cans. So let's get a good partner for kegs. So we ended up doing a deal with our keg partner, and they took kegs off our hands in terms of that keg delivery. Those kegs are not shelf stable. So as we're trying to adapt, we're trying to figure out shelf-stable ways of getting kegs on draft. We're not there yet, but we're looking into different things. So that's an evolution. We focused most of our energy on cans and brewing all of our kegs. We brew all of our kegs, you know, right down the street still. And now what we've realized is that first relationship of building kegs was probably our worst contract. And a lot of times those early contracts are, right? You're just by necessity. So we're trying to figure out how we can create a really good draft experience in ways that are not part of the contract that we signed originally, because they kind of control the marketplace. They're the number one keg, you know, delivery service in the country, so it's a good thing. But at the same point in time, if they want to jack our prices up, which they do, we have no control of that. So it's not a great relationship for us, so we're trying to figure out other innovative ways of delivering things on draft. But you know, we're working on, I think, some things that are happening now in like fast casual are more soda related type things, fountain soda things. So we brew the coffee into a smaller concentrated form, and then they will then add the water in line and then use a nitrogen tank. And that's probably going to hit pretty soon, both in offices and fast casual.
So your partners helped, but
yep,
you have the consumer piece, and then you have the competition piece.
Yep.
Right. You need to serve your consumer,
yeah,
but how did you balance them? Or how did you prioritize them?
prioritizing.
For instance, you know, you were basically in independent markets and the keg business in restaurants and bars. Then you went for big grocery and mass market distribution,
yep.
Right? So is that what you're getting after? How did you know it was time to go do that?
So, you know, it's interesting. There's so much value in being in the right local grocery store or local sandwich shop. And so we've always had tiers of high profile, high volume. Once we started realizing that we're growing and we need to make enough money to keep us growing, this is no longer three of us in here with no salary working on tips, we started saying, okay, well, where should our sales team be focused, right? And you get into 2,500 Walmarts with a good meeting, all of a sudden that's a pretty big deal. But we were in 2,000 stores and we just got into 2,500 Walmarts. So we said, let's start focusing on big grocery. And at that point in time, it was a little scary for us because, you know, we did grow from 2,000 to 15,000 stores. But it's been a very successful one because we timed the market well. Starbucks came out with Nitro Coffee, and there's Super Bowl commercials about Nitro Coffee. And we spent so much time saying, here's what Nitro Coffee is, here's why nitrogen, here's what makes it cascade. And now all of a sudden the question is more like, what does nitrogen add to the taste? It's not a learning experience of like not understanding. You know, people thought that they were going to explode. Literally, like, is this safe to drink is the thing. So we've said, let's focus our sales group on big grocery, but we still hit local level. And I think we have people now that drive around to every grocery store, major grocery store every day, and they hit 10 spots. And then we say, what are the high profile accounts? So high volume, high profile. But, you know, what we really learned is that trying to go to a lot of all the local spots, local delis, local bodegas, it can take up a lot of time, and sometimes those relationships aren't that great. So look for, like, the best of, like, those local, and then focus your energy on the, you know, high volume.
Right. Yeah, we haven't talked much about building consumer demand, and I'm sure there's a lot of advertising, marketing, promotion, social media. Could you just address what was critical for you on that?
Yeah. The feeling of being local is extremely important, whether we're here, whether we're in Oregon, whether we're in California, and seeing what those local events are. You know, like the local food events, the local concert series, that we're talking about the local chamber of commerce is like all throughout the country as well, and trying to like actually hit like local things so everybody feels like they're part of the story. The biggest thing for us is getting our liquid to lips. You know, we want to sample our products as much as possible. We do a lot of online advertising because we can't afford, you know, a Super Bowl ad yet. But in a lot of ways, it's
can be local.
Yeah, we do. Yeah, I mean, it's more effective doing it that way. And I think like we have a strong feeling of like sampling as much as possible at local events where people are having a good time and then they have a good experience with the product. We did a lot of grocery store sampling at the beginning, and that was great for us. You know, as you get into more stores, it's very hard to do that, right? It's like $100 per grocery demo, so you can't even do that. So you got to figure out new ways. Online sales have been really good for us, so we focused on online marketing and converting people. But you know, that's our challenge every day.
How do you manage the brand? You got to have marketing.
We, you know, at the very, very beginning, we were thinking about being a little more flat than regular companies were. I think Zappos does it really well. We started looking into some other brands that do it well. We're more structured now, but you know, I think between me and Grant's more on the finance investor side, we meet in the middle on product, and I'm more on the marketing side. And everybody's got value. We run like a total democracy where every vote counts, you know, and that goes from people who are part of the marketing team to not. You know, we send it out like, hey, here's our new design. What does everybody think? So we have a community-based marketing program, but, you know, we are building people. Now, I think in this day and age, it's like we do, you know, weekly meetings in person. I'm very old school, you know, which is all young people think that it's crazy that I want to call them instead of text them or Slack them. But we try and get in person as much as possible. And I think for the creative marketing side, I think it's really valuable. So you can all kind of